Hello, everybody. Welcome to Fellowship of the Word on May 9th. We're going to have a scripture reading by Miss Frieda Hammond.
Good morning. Well, it's good to meet with some of our folks here, and I do appreciate everything that's being done so that we can fellowship together no matter what. We're going through tough times like never before. The coronavirus has changed the world in how things are done. It is quite unsettling. Businesses, schools, and churches are closed. Restrictions are going and coming. Restrictions are in grocery stores. How much you can buy, stay 6 feet apart. Restrictions are on travel. Mass people are everywhere. Jobs are lost. Income is lost. Lives are lost. People are suffering with sorrow and grief. They are oppressed and fearful. In Psalms 31, David was in trouble. He was weak with sorrow and grief. He was oppressed. His foes had unjust, deliberate, and murderous purposes towards him. He was the contempt of his neighbors, and when his friends saw him, they fled from him. He was a broken man. He wrote in verse 13, fear was on every side and that they scheme to take away my life. When he was at his lowest, he cried out to God. I trust in you, O Lord. He began to find peace. When in verse 15, he wrote, my times are in your hands. So I'm going to read Psalms 31, 15 through 24. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face shine upon your servant. Do not let me be ashamed, O Lord, for I have called upon you. Let the wicked be ashamed. Let them be silent in the grave. Let the lying lips be put to silence, which speak insolent things proudly and contemptuously against the righteous. Oh, how great is your goodness, which you have laid up for those who fear you, which you have prepared for those who trust in you in the presence of the sons of men. You shall hide them in the secret place of your presence from the plots of man. You shall keep them secretly in a pavilion from the strife of tongues. Blessed be the Lord, for he has shown me his marvelous kindness in a strong city. For I said in my haste, I am cut off from before your eyes. Nevertheless, you heard the voice of my supplications when I cried out to you. Oh, love the Lord, all you his saints, for the Lord preserves the faithful and fully repays the proud person. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart, all ye who hope in the Lord. In our world today, fear and oppression is all around us. We must remember that David's God is our God. Though our lives have been changed, we should never forget God's unfailing love for us. So be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Our hope is in the Lord. Instead of fear, we can have peace when we place these times in his hands.
The message today I've entitled Overcoming Worldly Troubles, and the reason why I picked this message, you know, as usual, I was trying to figure out what to talk about. And really, it just made sense that almost in the same way as one of the previous times I spoke, I couldn't figure out what to talk about. And what I tried to do is just think about, well, what have I been dealing with lately and how troublesome it's been? And really, it has to do with overcoming these worldly troubles and these struggles that we face. And right now, it's really, really difficult. Obviously, we've been cooped up or whatever, to whatever degree. There's so much different information out there. All the contradictions of the communications that have been going on for everybody for the last 2 months or more. And it's no wonder that people are getting frustrated, because when you're hearing one thing, you're hearing another thing, and then another thing, and there's contradictions. And we all get it, that when people aren't understanding something, it takes time to figure something out. You got to work through it, just like we do with, you know, biblical studies, which is a lot to do with what I want to kind of address today. When we don't understand something, or we think something's a certain way, we get really adamant often about our belief and this sort of thing, and anything else that's out there that says otherwise. Oh no, that's wrong. And yet, there's this whole this whole thing going on of silencing and suppressing people's voices. And that's thought police kind of stuff. And it's very dangerous. And that's why this week's been a little bit more cumbersome or struggle. It's been more of a struggle for me than even the last couple of weeks dealing with the internet stuff and just a lot of technical things and deceptions and just fraud going on and confusion. And it's just really, really frustrating. So anyway, that's what I thought was a good topic for today. And the interesting thing is I watched a little video, I kind of got turned on lately to this, well, not just lately, I've heard about them for a while, this 119 Ministries people. And I really like the way they approach doctrinal issues, biblical issues in general and whatnot. There's just an air of humility there that is something that I think we should all take heed to and learn from. Anyway, so I want to start off with a short, it's about a 10-minute video that talks about a subject matter, and that's not actually the subject matter that we're going to be discussing, but it's an example. And I think this will help paint the picture and illustrate what I think is important for us to remember as Christians.
We expect that all would agree that walking out our faith is important. We advocate following the Torah, just as our Messiah practiced and taught. That is a centerpiece of our apologetics-based ministry. In that, we do our best to interpret and apply the Torah as God intended to the best of our understanding. Even though we make every attempt to do that well, and only to glorify Yahweh, some understandably disagree with 119 Ministries on some of our presented conclusions. We find it rare that anyone agrees with us 100% should they view all of our 400-plus teachings. Many of these points of contention are regarding small things. Sometimes these points of contention are regarding more impactful issues. The point is this. Sometimes there will be disagreement with 119 Ministries, or really, any ministry for that matter. If any teacher demands 100% agreement with everything they teach, that would be a cult. We do not expect you to agree with 119 100%. If you do, we are actually a little concerned. We are likely wrong on some things. This is why we encourage all to test everything. No one has everything figured out. We even find that after some time and further testing, we disagree with our own previous conclusions on a doctrine that we may have presented in a teaching. When that happens, we start over and try to do better. One of the topics that often finds itself in the bucket of emails expressing disagreement with 119 Ministries is the detailed mechanics of how to calculate and observe God's calendar. As most of us know, there is the modern Gregorian calendar that much of the world follows, and there is the biblical calendar that determines Yahweh's Moedim, or appointed times, God's holidays, if you will. For those who are interested in learning about our thoughts on how to calculate Yahweh's calendar, for whatever it might be worth, please see our teaching series, Time, Our Creator's Calendar. It is a complicated topic for us in the faith. It is a passionate topic for many. It is also a topic that many believers claim to have it all figured out without any possibility for error. And many people absolutely love to tell others how easy it is and so obvious to see that they are right. Regardless of how easy or difficult it might be to determine the proper calculation of Yahweh's calendar, the reality is that we will not likely be united on this topic until Messiah Yeshua returns and sets us all straight. Does that mean we should abandon trying to determine and observe the correct calendar? No, we wouldn't say that, and here is why. We all desire to follow God, to love God, and to love others. We do this by studying and following the word that He gave to us. We should all do our best to follow the word to the best of our understanding. We should never stop trying to do that better each and every day. Even in our own presentation of what we believe to be the likely calculation of God's calendar, we spend the majority of our opening dialogue stating how we could be wrong. If we could be wrong, then that clearly means that others could be right. We will all stand before the Creator someday, and we all want to stand before Him and say that we made every attempt to follow His word. Where we fail, we'll be covered by His grace. We all desire to follow His word to the best of our understanding. We should all follow the word how we understand it, not how someone tells us. Listen to those who challenge your understanding. Test it to Scripture, but don't simply follow someone else's understanding of the Word without understanding and agreeing to it yourself. So what is the point of all of this? The point is that we likely need to accept the reality that these calendar differences will exist until Yeshua's return. Unless new research or ancient information comes to light, there is not one ministry or individual that is going to get us all on the same page regarding the calendar. Many people will not believe something even if it can be proven, and many have their own proof to back up their beliefs. But if we are all responsible for our own interpretations on how to follow the Word, how is that a problem? Well, how many believe it is important to assemble with others in the faith? Hebrews chapter 10. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as it is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Not only is assembling together important, as we approach the coming day of the Lord in which Yeshua returns, it will become even more important. How does that relate to the biblical calendar? In the first century, as practiced by Messiah Yeshua and the apostles, those in the faith assembled on the feast days and the seventh-day Sabbath. These were the days which all work was to cease. It provided a perfect time to assemble together, worship, and study the Word. When we are all observing different calendars, a breakdown happens here. With all these different calendars, how do we assemble together? What can be done so that we can gather together despite our differences? The best way we know how to answer that is to explain what the 119 Ministries team has done, as one example. Some might be surprised to hear that not everyone on the 119 Ministries team follows the same calendar, and it's been done that way for years. It becomes even further convoluted when those that we have Bible study with currently and in the past have also followed different calendars. How did we deal with it but not forsake assembling together? Did we separate and divide? No. Each family would rest on the days they believed they were to rest. Our individual families would observe the Moedim on the days we believe we are to observe the Moedim. In addition, we would also find a day to observe and get together as a group. We admit that this can be hard to do if one calendar places some observances a month apart. But we made it work the best that we were able as often as we were able. For example, perhaps this year you celebrate the Day of Trumpets on a Tuesday, and your congregation is assembling together on a Thursday. What can be done? Perhaps you can blow some trumpets on Tuesday with your family and rest as we are commanded to rest. But can you still assemble with your congregation on Thursday? Of course you can. Even better, right? These are some of the things that we have done to make things work. Despite the calendric differences, we valued each other. We all brought great conversation to the table. We all depended on one another. We did not divide over the calendar. We made it work. Sometimes it was easy, sometimes it was hard, but we put forth effort because we loved and cared for each other. Consider the weightier matters of the Torah. It's more important to love and care for each other than to agree on calendar days. Sure, we entertain discussions about the calendar from time to time, trying to understand each family's perspective better. But the point is this: we made it work despite these differences, and quite frankly, many other doctrinal differences. As we near the day of Yeshua's return, we all need each other that much more. We should be looking for reasons to bring us all together, not highlighting where we all differ on minor issues and using such as an excuse to go our separate ways. Sure, there are going to be reasons where some will have to part ways, as certain doctrines could be considered dangerous or incompatible with the Torah. We're not naive. That is going to happen from time to time. But perhaps the question should be asked, do we need to divide over this? Or can we all assemble together in a shared love and worship of our Creator? Hebrews chapter 10. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. So if we can encourage you with this, whenever possible, assemble together despite differences. The adversary wants to divide and conquer. It is Yahweh who sees us as the body of the Messiah. In summary, it's doubtful there will ever be full agreement with calendric calculation and implementation until Yeshua's return. We do not think that most people are intentionally trying to cause problems in their different calendar interpretations. Most simply want to follow the Torah the best that they are able. We cannot fault people for that. In fact, we should be encouraging it. We would rather have them make every attempt to follow the Torah as they believe they should follow it, even if it causes some differences. Because no matter what, our collective application of the Torah is going to produce differences regardless, even outside the boundaries of the calendar. However, what we should not allow that to do is cause division based on debatable matters, nor neglect the assembling with others. We pray that this teaching has blessed you. And remember, continue to test everything. Shalom.
So let me just start out by reading a scripture having to do with overcoming the worldly things, worldly troubles and struggles, trials, tribulations, and whatnot. 1 John 4:3-5. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is he who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? So as I said, I had a couple difficult weeks. I guess we've all had many difficult weeks, so who am I kidding, right? Worldly troubles. I've had a hard time struggling with deceit and fraud, which abounds, especially lately. And that leads me to anger and depression if I'm not careful. If I'm not careful to remain in God's spirit in everything I do and think, especially thinking, because we think first and then it comes out through the mouth. So it's been a very difficult time for all of us and dealing with worldly struggles. And this video helped remind me of how we really should be dealing with struggles and trials and disagreements, especially lately when we're dealing with, you know, online arguments and different things. So as you can tell by now, probably is the primary message of the video is not really about the calendar and dealing with the calendar issues. The point of the message to me is that there's a priority of love that exists over doctrine. For the doctrine is to help us grow in God's love. That's really what all our teachings is supposed to do. It's the law is to bring us to Christ. And Christ and the Father dwell in us, in their Holy Spirit within us, and they are writing their laws and commandments in our heart. And that's part of what I understand as the new covenant. So what I think is so important is to keep that focus in the forefront of our minds, that if we're not showing love, and I was going to throw the scripture in, but you know, the greatest of these is love, you know, faith, hope, love. And that scripture talks about that, you know, you can do all these wonderful works and do all these things, but if you don't really have genuine love, it really doesn't amount to a whole lot. It's faking it. And that's not what God is looking for. God's not looking for a faker. He's looking for honesty and real sincerity, integrity, and these types of things, you know? So it really hit me hard just watching this, because it's been an issue anyway over the years with church brethren really get heated over it. As you can tell, this whole thing with the two brethren arguing with each other, you know, as he was describing how people, you know, people of the faith get really passionate, extremely passionate over doctrine. And a lot of times they get so passionate that they're debating and arguing with each other. And Messiah says we're not supposed to debate over scripture. We should reason together. We're supposed to, you know, strive to figure out what God's messages are through the scripture. But we're supposed to do that in the spirit of love with one another, not beating each other over the head and saying you're wrong and all that sort of stuff. I love that one little section where he puts up the guy, you know, my way's always right and you're always wrong, that type of thing. And it's something to really think about. Another scripture to think of here with overcoming when we're in these situations, especially lately with online arguments and stuff over this whole COVID thing that's going on. Romans 12:21 says, do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And that is such a poignant scripture to remember. It's just the fundamental understanding of how we're supposed to battle the adversary, how we're supposed to battle deceit. You know, I want truth. And this is something that I think we all, as believers in Christ, followers of Christ, we want truth. This is what God has put this in our hearts, that we want truth. We want to take the red pill every time, no matter how painful it is, because without truth, what's the point, right? And we can't navigate through this world without having that solid foundation in God's truth. And His Spirit helps us stay that way, and it helps us overcome the evil and the deceptions with good, with love. That's the only way it's going to work. And getting back to that whole, you know, why I'm right and everyone else is wrong comment there, something to think about is, how effective is spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ by being an arrogant know-it-all, right? And I'm speaking to myself as much as anybody, because I've come off for years with friends, just as long as I can remember, being an only child brat type of person. I'm just arrogant. I just grew into this arrogant kind of attitude, and it's taken me a long time to try to get over it. And it's not easy. And then when you're dealing with people, especially online, is the worst time. You know, when you're texting and stuff, and you're dealing with somebody that makes just a total ridiculous statement about whatever, and you're like, dude, you know, come on. But you know, again, we have to remember that God hasn't opened up the eyes of the world. He's opening up people's eyes, and ourselves too. He's opening up our eyes and understanding the things as we can handle it, right? Remember this, the term in the movie, whatever the name of the movie is, you know, you can't handle the truth, right? Well, there's some truth to that, I think. And it has to do with, you know, what Christ said, even his disciples at times, when he said, you know, I'm trying to give you physical things, try to explain physical things. How can I possibly give you all these spiritual things to think about when you're not even understanding the physical thing? So it just takes time. It takes time. And I used to look at it as, come on, God, hurry up, God, that type of thing. No, it's hurry up, Bernard. You know, hurry up, Bernard. Why don't you get this? Because it's not God that's slow. It's me. The creator of everything isn't slow. He's a genius, right? Beyond any of our imagination. So it's not his problem. It's our problem that it takes patience on our part to allow ourselves to have the time for God to work with us, because it just takes time for us to get over ourselves, is the way I kind of look at it, right? Matthew 16 and verse 6. Then Jesus said to them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have taken no bread. Drop down to 11, it says, how is it that you do not understand that I did not speak to you concerning bread, but to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees? Then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And the interesting thing is, when we put scriptures together, here a little and there a little, the doctrine of the Pharisees and Sadducees, in some cases, the teaching might actually be accurate. The problem is, again, if they're acting as a know-it-all and they're just being belligerent or whatever, you know, how is that going to appear? I got a couple things to think about on that. You know, consider the thoughts which come to mind related to the word Pharisee. When somebody just uses the word Pharisee, what are the thoughts that come to mind? Well, there's two things that come to my mind, and I double-checked the definition just to see if I'm missing any others, and quite frankly, there was only two things there in Merriam's dictionary and the Urban Dictionary, because I wanted to kind of get it, a wide variety of what are the different definitions from different kinds of dictionaries. So Merriam is one, Merriam-Webster, and of course the Urban Dictionary is a very far apart from that. But it's hypocrisy and self-righteousness. Those are really what it boils down to. And that's what the world thinks of, not just us. If you hear the word Pharisee, that word has, you know, existed throughout time and come down through generations after generations and thousands of years, literally. And it means the same thing all the time to people, which is hypocrisy and self-righteousness. So we have to be careful about that leaven, right, of how we approach matters with brethren or with anyone in the world. And the other thing to consider how acting like a Pharisee might appear to the rest of the world. And of course, the scripture that comes to my mind in that is John 13, 34 and 35, which says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all will know
that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. So we have to really be careful about that, because there's that scripture that is so important. Avoid even the appearance of evil. It is such an important scripture that early on in my studies, I didn't think of it as so important of a scripture, but now I think it's one of the more important scriptures, because if we are not viewed, if you appear as doing something evil, even though you're not doing something evil, it still says to whoever that's appearing, you know, or viewing that, that, hey, there's someone that can't be with Christ, or if that's Christ, if that's a Christian, I don't want to have anything to do with it. And quite frankly, my opinion has been for a long time that Christianity in general, or the way in which people have acted like Pharisees who call themselves Christians, have turned off so many people from Christ. They've just pushed people away that, you know, God could be calling at that moment. And so it's so careful. We have to be so careful about that. Another scripture that I want to share, and these are also were in the video, but I just want to go over real quick, is Luke 18 and verse 7 and 8, which says, "And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, when he returns, will he really find faith on the earth?" You know, what does that faith mean? How can we have a good show of faith if we're doing this all the time over doctrines that we agree, like in that example, the calendar thing? All of us who believe Torah, that understand Torah, for the most part, we believe we're supposed to obey, right? Obey God and do the things that he says to do. There's one law for Jew and Gentile. So when he says, okay, I want you to keep this weekly Sabbath, I want you to keep these appointed times throughout the year, these are commands. These are things that God wants us to do. It's his will. So if we're arguing, I mean, we all agree we want to do these things, but if we're going to beat each other up over how we do them, what does that show to the rest of the world, first of all? When other people can get together and not argue and kill each other, right? And beat each other up over, should we get together early one day or late one day, and all these types of things. So what does that show? We have to really think about that. Matthew 23, here's another one. And this is the one that, you know, again, I included it in the video. Matthew 23, 23 and 24. Again, looking at this whole Pharisaical attitude thing, being hypocrites. "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. Blind guides who strain out a gnat and swallow a camel." And that's what the world sees. If we don't know how to grow, and if we're not working on continually building our faith, strengthening, I heard a sermon 20 more years ago, strengthening that faith muscle. I'll never forget that one. It was a neat idea that faith, the concept was that faith is sort of like a muscle. And if you don't use a muscle over time, it atrophies. So it'll get weakened. Same thing with faith. You have to continually walk in faith, use it continually, or it'll be weakened, and then it won't be as easy to overcome worldly trials and tribulations if we're weaker in the faith, right? It makes sense. Galatians 5, 22 through, looks like 26. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control." You see, those are two big ones I've had a hard time with over this past week especially. "Against such, there is no law. And those who are Christ's have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, like arrogant and all, right? Provoking one another, envying one another." So again, this conceited thing. Let's not be conceited and arrogant, thinking we're so self-righteous that we have all this knowledge, or we have all this understanding, and that I'm so special. Yeah, we're all special. But I would submit that everyone is special to God. Walking in the Spirit has to do, again, with just avoiding the Pharisaical mentality. And as we read through the scriptures, the people Christ hammered the most needed the hammering, right? And that was the priests of the time. That was the priests of the day that were acting self-righteous and all this. So this is just, these are the kind of things we need to focus on when we're dealing with, you know, different subjects or whatever in the faith. So a couple things, I pulled up a couple scriptures on anger and depression. So I just want to read these. The thing that has troubled me the most, as I shared a little bit already, has to do with this censorship thing. You know, if somebody puts out information and it's wrong, let's say somebody is a fraud, the way it should be dealt with is not to suppress it, prohibit it, or ban it. The way to deal with it in a righteous manner is to look at that, what they're presenting, and then refute it through the spirit of God's love, through facts. That's what you do. That's how you deal with anything that's false, is you point out the facts and the truth without condemning the person or anything, and you focus on that. And as I said, it's just very difficult, especially when we allow ourselves online to deal with this method of communication that has no emotion for the most part. Okay, I've kind of shared this before. I'm not a writer. I'm not a good writer. It's taken me 30 years of practicing to write just to get to the point where I could actually write now maybe an article that I can convey the thoughts the way I am feeling like I need to convey them. I've never been that up on being, yay, what a great writer, this writer or the other person. But now I have more sympathy and empathy, I guess, with how much talent or wherewithal and effort it takes to convey a thought properly and accurately. It's very difficult. To think that now anyone in the masses can do that online in just a few words here and there on instant messaging and all this stuff, it's just kind of insane to think about that way. Because we've dumbed ourselves down through technology to a degree by certain applications and stuff that only allow so much text to be said to begin with. And then, as you know, the dialogue of society has changed so much over time. And I think part of the reason has to do with God's plan in distributing or dispersing the languages and whatnot. English, as you know, is a language that has borrowed various languages throughout time. And that's why it gets so very confusing, because you have a word borrowed from French, you have a word borrowed from German or this, that, Latin and whatnot. And all these words come in, and then meanings is a whole other thing. As we know, even in ancient Hebrew and Greek, words have multiple meanings, which is usually the biggest problem. One of the biggest problems I found was that in mistranslations biblically as to why people wind up on a different page of a particular doctrine. It's because the words have so many different meanings. Well, which meaning are we using for evening? Meaning are we using for this, that, and the other thing? There's just all these factors involved that have to do with language. God did this deliberately. So while I don't like it, and something I've had a hard time with, is this whole, I want things to be very precise. I want, if a word means something, I want it to mean one thing and one thing only and not have all this confusion. But that's, you know, it's not the way it is. So it's up to us to work through that and deal with it. So let me read a couple of scriptures here regarding the anger thing. Ephesians 4, and I'm going to read from the 25 through 32. Ephesians 4, 25 through 32. Therefore, putting away lying, let each one of you speak truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. Now that, I'll tell you what, that one little phrase there, actually that whole sentence, be angry and do not sin, do not let the sun go down on your wrath, is so important for me. It has saved me so many times lately, especially lately, getting angry with someone I don't even know, okay? And just letting it get to me. Or getting angry with somebody I do know and letting it get to me. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. In other words, okay, you're gonna get angry. There's a time to hate. There is actually a legitimate time to hate, but get over it. I mean, don't dwell in the hatred. Be angry and then let it go. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath, because it ain't gonna hurt anybody else but you. And that's the thing we gotta remember, right? So that's helped me so much. All right, nor give place to the devil, which if you continue to be angry all the time, guess what? You're giving place to the devil. You're entertaining negative spirits, not godly spirits. Let him who stole, steal no longer, repent, okay? But rather let him labor, working with his hands what is good, that he may have something to give him who has need. Let no corrupt word proceed out of your mouth, but what is good for necessary edification, that it might impart grace to the hearers. So again, overcome that evil with good, as we read in Romans, 12:21, Don't let this negativity come out of your mouth. Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. Get rid of it. Be done with it. And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you. Grieving the Holy Spirit. You know, when I think of that term or that phrase, grieve the Holy Spirit or grieving the Holy Spirit, I think so much of the unpardonable sin, in the sense that if you're grieving the Holy Spirit, the way I see it is you're rejecting it continually. You're saying, no, God, I don't want your Holy Spirit. And that's the way I see it anyway, is how we commit that unpardonable sin. It's not that God can't forgive us for that sin. It's that as long as we're rejecting God, as long as we're rejecting God and his Holy Spirit, he wants to forgive us, but we have to get to the point where we're asking for forgiveness. We have to get to that point. And if we're not doing that, then God's not going to force himself on us. He's not like Satan. Satan forces his way upon others, while God presents the truth, and it's up to us to decide to either obey or disobey. It's really pretty much that simple. Ecclesiastes 7 and verse 9, do not hasten in your spirit to be angry, for anger rests in the bosom of fools. That's a good one. Do not hasten in your spirit to be angry, for anger rests in the bosom of fools. I don't want to be a fool. Okay, I don't want to be fooled. I'm tired of being fooled in my life. I'm tired of making mistakes. I'm going to keep making them, unfortunately, but I'm tired of making same mistakes. That's what bothers me a lot. And I'm sure it bothers God, because I'm only hurting myself, right? When I continually make a bad mistake over again, that's why we repent of those mistakes. Depression, a couple scriptures real quick on depression. Okay, Proverbs 12 and verse 25. Anxiety in the heart of man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. So here, anxiety, again, anxiety is this thing that happens when we get concerned to the point of worry, right? God says we're not supposed to be worrying. Now, we have different, you know, we're all a different level of worry war, and we also have different things that we worry about more than other things. So again, when something doesn't go right, and I have the hardest time with this, I'd say of almost anybody, I need to relax, take a deep breath, ask God for a little help, and help me with my memory, and don't panic so I can think straight, right? That's key. One of the things I want to say, getting back to the video real quick, the issue of trying to figure out the calendar thing, calendar chaos as they call it, I love the way they call it that, because there is chaos involved. There's chaos involved when people come together to try to figure stuff out. We can't, we get upset about it, right? A long time ago, I was of the opinion that, okay, everything's got to be figured out about all this stuff. We got to get everybody on the same page. It took me a while to realize, wait a minute, because I saw other church groups, you know, you share stuff. When you go to the feast, you meet people from different places. And this is like after I first started going to the feast, some of the first people I met, because I was asking these questions. Well, how do you guys, do you have anybody that believes a different way, uses different calendars? Oh, yeah. How did you deal with it? Well, because I wanted to get everybody on the same page, right? It's got to do it right, got to do it right, or wrong. Well, what she said was basically the same thing that was mentioned here. And so over time, I came to a new understanding. I think it's a better understanding. That's just my opinion. Is that it's kind of the way we do the Super Sabbath thing. There are people that, and I think Tripp shared this years ago, and we came up with this idea to assume the special Super Sabbaths, you know, near the new moons. Tripp, I think, shared that there was a group somewhere that came to the understanding of, well, hey, look, ancient Israel used to actually observe the new moons, and they did sacrifice. I did this whole study about, you know, where they did sacrifices and all the stuff, just like any other holy day. So there's a group out there that decided, oh, we want to do this together. We want to start observing the new moons. They apparently were trying to figure out, well, how are we going to do it? Are we going to do it by the conjunction? Are we going to do it by the first sighting? Are we going to do it for Jerusalem? You know, all these different issues that can come up, different ways to do it. What he said was, if I remember correctly, is that they couldn't agree. They couldn't come up with a methodology of doing it to where they could all be somewhat happy about doing it and for God, because that's really why we're doing it. God says, hey, do this, okay? That they didn't do it. They just said, we're not gonna do it, because they couldn't get around the arguments over it. And what we came up with was the concept, which we still do, is we just grab the closest weekly Sabbath to the new moon, and we do it then. And we observe it, and it helps. And one of the reasons why we did this, it wasn't that we felt like, well, we were really, really sinning and not doing it. It helps us in God's timing because, you know, we're steeped in Babylon, right? We're steeped in a system. It's all out of whack. It's just not anywhere like what God set up for us, right? So we need a little help in counting the months and knowing when is, you know, Pentecost coming up? When is the feast coming up? And so it helps with that. It helps get us more in tune with that. And what Tripp said that one day was that he thought that, if I remember correctly, he said something to the effect of, it seems like you guys came up with a way of obeying the spirit of the law, if not the perfect letter. And I think this is what we're talking about here to a degree. Most people, I don't know of anyone I haven't met in the churches of God that didn't genuinely want to do things according to God's way. In other words, the goal I've found from everybody, pretty much as far as I know, everybody I've met in the Church of God, the goal is to obey God to the best ability possible and to understand accordingly and to do accordingly. So like they said in the video, I don't think that there's many people out there that just want to, you know, not do that. So if we understand, we're trying to figure it out. And that's how these people work through it. They work through it in different ways. I suggested it years ago and with different groups after I learned how different groups were doing it. And frankly, one of the groups that used to meet with us did, as far as I know, they had at least three different factions within their group that did things slightly differently at different times, different ways, but they all got back together on the following Sabbath or whatever. So, you know, as exemplified, at least these guys did it. We've had other groups in Church of Gods that have done it. And again, it comes down to walking in the Spirit. Don't provoke one another. I mean, that's the last thing we should do. And we really shouldn't be provoking anybody in the world either. We shouldn't be online poking people's buttons. Now, some things you're going to say are going to, you know, provoke anybody, no matter what you say and how you say something, is going to, you know, someone's going to get provoked. A long time ago, I like Monty Python, and years ago, MTV used to run Monty Python, and they had a little disclaimer at the front before they started the flying circus thing that said something to the effect of, this show can sometimes be offensive to people. So if you're easily offended, please do us both a favor and don't watch, you know? So, I mean, and that's the way we should really kind of think about these things when we're dealing with people. If we can't handle a conversation at any given time without condemning the person, then just be quiet. Just don't say anything. It'd be better off. Or, you know, be quiet, think about it, pray about it, let it simmer, you know, and then God will help you once you're thinking straight how to approach the issue to help that person and have real edification going on through God's Spirit. John 16 and verse 33 says, "These things I've spoken to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Okay? Christ overcomes the world. He overcame the world, and that's what we do through him. We can and we will overcome this world. It's just some growing pains, I think, that we have to deal with, and we have to remember to, again, always think about the scriptures that help us get through it. Think about how to deal with the people that we're arguing with about something. Try not to argue. Try to state what you believe and why, and let it go. And pray for the person that you're arguing with. Pray for yourself. God, I need guidance, right? I need patience to deal with this person because they're really pressing my buttons about a particular subject. You know, we all have different things that are going to press our buttons, right? So these are the things that we need to keep in mind.